Welded Joints. We've just finished bolted joints, and that was an application of one formula out of the three. Don't forget, we have three formulas: stress equals force over area, strain equals extension over original length, and modulus of elasticity equals stress over strain. With welded joints, all we're really doing is the same formula we did in bolted joints, this one only. We're not worried about the stretching or the stiffness of the joint. We're only interested in the amount of force that we can handle. So we're looking at stress equals force over area, and that's it. I want to talk about two types of weld. And the two types of weld that we're going to do for analysis is the butt weld, where you're just welding one plate in line with another plate, and the fillet weld, where you have one plate at a corner or perpendicular to another plate. So the fillet weld and the butt weld. With a butt weld, there's not really any calculation to do, because that material is taking the place of the parent material. And so all we do is give it a factor, what percentage of the original strength. Just like when we had bolted joints, which had joint efficiency, well, this percentage is actually joint efficiency. And in the textbook, Ivanov assumes 90% for our butt joint. So you're given a butt joint, what's the strength of the joint? 90% of the original plate. That's it. In practice, a butt joint usually needs some sort of preparation as the plates get thicker. So we've got some examples of these here in the PDF. Different sorts of butt joints depending on the thickness. When it gets thicker, sometimes you have to come and weld from both sides of the plate so you get enough penetration, and you have to prepare the plates with bevel edges on here so that the weld can fill up and get penetration all the way to the center of the plate when they're very thick. Another type of welding is resistance welding, where you're using electric current to run from one electrode through to the other electrode, and then the connection between the two plates happens to be the highest resistance, because this would typically be made of copper, and the connection between copper and steel is pretty good, but the connection between steel and steel is the worst one, so that's where the most resistance is, and hopefully that's where you get the heat from. So there's some limitations. For example, you have a thick steel here and a thin one there, you can have trouble. And if you can't get to the other side, that's also a problem. So it works really well for two pieces of sheet metal of equal thickness. There's a spot weld. And a related welding process is used for making tubes. It is called electro-resistance welding. And you start with a flat sheet, you roll the sheet around so that it would make a C shape, which touches together. And just as it's touching together, you send electric current through the joint and weld those together with a continuous weld here, electric weld. So all the tubes, ERW tubes, you'll notice there'll be a bit of flash on the inside because they can't clean that one up. They clean up the outside, but the inside one they can't get to. So that's how you can tell. That's the sort of tube that they use for furniture, and you can't use it for pressure because it's likely to bust right here. But it's used for most ordinary pipe. We're back to the fillet weld situation. A little bit more work to do with a fillet weld. Now, the main key with a fillet weld, really, is that the size of the weld, which is S, size of the weld, is not the same as the thickness of the weld. Now, the thickness of the weld we call the throat, T. So because this is 45 degrees, we're assuming it's 45 degrees, then the force comes along this plate and then has to transfer across the weld and then into that plate there. And while it's doing that, it can only go through the thin part of the weld, which is this throat. What this doesn't take into account is a certain amount of penetration. So if we were to look carefully at a weld, we'd notice that the weld itself penetrates into the parent material as well. But we're not taking that into account. So the actual weld might be more like this size. And so we've really got a little bit extra. So to be on the conservative side, we're not counting any extra. We only count the throat directly from there to there, which is 0.7 of the size of the weld using a 45 degree triangle. So where do we get the 0.7 from? That's S, this is 45 degrees, this is the hypotenuse. So we're trying to get this thickness here, T. So sine of 45 is T over S. And sine 45 is, and we're trying to find T, so T equals S sine 45 and sine 45 is 0.707s. So that's where T equals 0.707s. T equals 0.707s from sine 45. All we do now is apply the stress formula. Let's see what happens when we put the stress formula in here. Imagine that all the force is going from one plate to the other plate, and it has to transfer through the weld, and it has to go through this little cross section here. So the first thing we want is, what is the total area of the weld that the force goes through? The weld looks like that. The cross section goes through here. So if I can work out the area through here, that's area. Once I get the area, I can do stress equals force over area. So how do I work out the area? I need the throat thickness, which is, this is a rectangle, this thing. This is T, the throat of the weld, and this is the length of the weld, L. So area equals T, L. So I'm trying to work out how much force this can hold. So force from here equals stress times area. Stress is the stress that I'm allowed in the weld, or I could use this symbol. And area is TL, so that's equal to stress times thickness times length. And thickness is 0.707s. So I get stress times 0.707s times L. Or rearranging this in the other order, 0.707, stress, length, size. So S is the size of the weld measured along the flat. L is the length of the weld. Stress is the allowable stress in the weld, and 0.707 comes from 45 degrees. There's only one thing we need before we've completed, and that is, what are we using for stress here? We use a factor of safety with this weld chapter of 3. So if this was an electrode, 410 megapascal electrode, then we divide that by 3, giving us 136 megapascals. It depends on the question, but we're hiding in there a factor of safety of 3 as well. That factor of safety could be something else, but for the questions we're doing, we'll either be given the allowable stress of the weld, which is just given in the question, or it might be that you need to apply the factor of safety. All the ones in the book use factor of safety on a 410 electrode, so they're all 136. That's it. Most of the time when you're doing a question, you're going to be asked either for the size of the weld or the length of the weld. So it might say it's an 8mm weld, find out how long it should be, or it might say this is the length of the weld, find out the size that you need to do. In practice, we're not going to specify a weld of 4.35mm, because there's no welder can sit there and make sure it's exactly 4.35. They'll just round it off to some standard numbers which they use. But quite often we do a calculation, double check it, and then we round it up to the next number that they're using in the workshop. Quite often in a design, they want to weld all the way around so that water can't get in or something like that, in which case the weld could be 10 times stronger than necessary. Some examples, there's some examples of fillet welds in there. One other thing with these questions, just watch how you calculate the length of the weld. For example, we're running this weld all the way around the perimeter of this bracket. What is the length here? Do we take this bottom corner here, or the top corner, or what? When you're working out the length of the weld, you always use the root length. What's the length in the corner? So in this case, the length will be right in the corner between the bracket and the plate, which is this length in here.